Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God. We are now here live. Grateful to God for another Wednesday noonday worship service. Coming to you live on Facebook. Thanking and praising God for another opportunity to come in and worship his name in spirit and in truth. I hope you all are blessed. Y'all come on in. Come on in. Let's praise God together. We've got something to praise God for because he's worthy of all the praise, the glory, and the honor. Wednesday is here. We are thankful to God. Yes, come on in. Come on in. Join us live for our Facebook Live Wednesday noonday worship service on today. We are thankful to God for all of you joining us on today. Hey, Tamika, God bless you. Good to see you. Hope and pray you and the girls are doing well. Amen. Good afternoon, Sister Tidwell. God bless you. Good to see you. Amen. God be praised. Come on in and join us. Sister Paige, God bless you. God bless you. Good afternoon to everyone. Sister Goss, God bless you. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Katie and Tim Breland, God bless you as well. I have a response for y'all soon. Amen. I got a lot of stuff going on. Amen. Sister Cynthia Bell, God bless. Good to see you. Sister Johnny Mae Young, God bless you, sweetheart. God bless. Amen. God bless all of you. Thank you for joining us for our noonday worship on today. We're going to go ahead and get started. It's so good to see everybody. Amen. So good to see everybody. I'm just feeling a little down home today. I guess must be just the time or the season. So I'm going to do a little song and let's see if y'all can follow me. Amen. Hopefully you can. You don't have to be from down home to know this song. Amen. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Oh, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Come on. Glory, glory. Anybody feel like it? Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Y'all remember this verse? Oh, I feel better. So much better. Since I laid my burdens down. Oh, I feel better. So much better. Oh, since I lay my burdens down. Y'all remember this verse? Oh, friends don't treat me, yeah. Oh, like they used to. Oh, since I lay my burdens down. Oh, friends don't treat me, yeah, like they used to. Oh, since I laid my burdens down. Come on, I feel better. Yeah, so much better. Oh, since I laid my burdens down. Oh, I feel better. So much better. Oh, since I laid my burdens down. Come on, back to glory, glory. Oh, glory, glory. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, since I laid my burdens down. Oh, glory, glory. Yeah, hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Amen. Amen. A little throwback. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we come this afternoon saying thank you. We thank you, God, for allowing us to gather together just to lift up a praise, just to give you the glory, the honor, Lord God, knowing who you are. Now, God, bless us as we come now into this time of worship, this noonday period, Lord, where this service is designed just to encourage the hearts of believers and those who may be feeling some kind of way that on this midweek, midday service, Lord, that we can get a boost of energy that comes to us by way of your word through song and scripture. Bless us now, God, as we go forth. And allow us, Lord God, to feel your presence even through the Facebook lines. Lord, we love you, adore you, and we bless you. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray and ask it all. Amen. And thank God. Amen. Amen. I'm going to give us our scripture for today. And there's so much meat on this bone, y'all, that I had to break this sermon up into two parts. So we're going to get part one today and part two on next Wednesday. But if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to the book of Revelation. The Revelation, amen, one Revelation. Revelation chapter 5. And I want to read the entire fifth chapter in its entirety, all 14 verses. Revelation chapter 5, beginning at verse 1 and ending at verse 14. Here's what the word of the Lord says. Revelation 5, verse 1. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, and neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And behold, and I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns, seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sung a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. I love it, y'all. And I beheld and heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beast and the elders. And the numbers of them were 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forevermore. And the four beasts said, amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him that liveth forever and ever. Ooh, I can't wait to dive deep into Revelation chapter 5. Amen. So y'all put a pen right there, and we're going to get to it, but get to part one anyway today. But I do have a few announcements and events of interest for us, and I want to give them quickly. One, we are having an awesome time in our Fall Institute. Our Fall Institute has been taking place now for the past two nights. We have two more nights left tonight, Wednesday and Thursday. And our Fall Institute deals around race and race relations and understanding how we as the body of Christ need to learn and work together. And we have a great facilitator, Dr. F. Willis Johnson is with us. If you want to join us, you still can. We still have registration open, I believe, through today. And so you can come in and be a part. It's from 7 to about 8:30 each night. And there's wisdom and nuggets that are given to us by Dr. Johnson. He was on the ground during the Michael Brown murder and tragedy that took place in Ferguson, Missouri. He now resides in Columbus, Ohio, and is pastor of the Tree of Life United Methodist Church and is doing a great, great work. So come on in and join us. Listen, we have an open and honest dialogue around race, and I think it's a subject matter that we need to be discussing. And we're also being proactive to talk about how we as the body of Christ can learn how to engage and learn how to work with one another during the times that we're living in. So join us tonight, 7:00. Now, because of the Institute, there will be no adult Bible study on tonight. I'm asking all of our adults to join us in Bible study. However, Pastor Nicholas Young will be having his youth Bible studies beginning at 6 p.m. all the way through 8 p.m. tonight. So for all of our elementary, our middle, our high school A and high school B, from 6 to 6:30 is elementary, 6:30 to 7 is middle school, 7 to 7:30 is high school A, and 7:30 to 8 is high school B. If you are a 9th, 10th grader, you are a part of high school A. If you are 11th and 12th grader, you are a part of high school B. Join Pastor Nick this tonight, depending upon where you are grade-wise, and he has an exciting word for our young people, and we're excited about what Pastor Nick is doing. So young people, you can go there beginning at 6. We're asking the adults to join us in our Fall Institute. Also, just a reminder, our new disciples class will take place this Saturday. This Saturday at 10 a.m., the Lord is still adding to his church, even in the midst of this pandemic. And so I'm grateful to God, and I can't wait to see our new disciples who will come to be a part. If you are newly joined to the church and you have not had our new disciples class, come on in. It's through our Zoom Bible study that we'll have it at 10 a.m. on this coming Saturday. And it runs from 10 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Also, this Sunday, we're excited about what God is doing with Pastor and People Together. We'll be celebrating my 9th anniversary at First Baptist Church of Guilford. I'm excited about it. We're going to acknowledge what God is doing. And Dr. Michael T. Scott will be with us from the Galilee Baptist Church of Kalamazoo, Michigan. He is somebody's preacher. And so Sunday, join us right here. You don't want to miss it. God be praised. Thank you all so much for what you continue to do in the body of Christ. And we ask that you all be prayerful about what God is going to continue to do in the days and weeks and months and years to come with Pastor and People. That concludes our announcements for today. We ask that you govern yourselves accordingly. I'm going to ask my beautiful wife to come and bless us with a selection. I didn't give her anything today. Amen. So she's going to come bless us in her own way. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. It is good to be before you one more time, one more week. Aren't you glad that the Lord allowed us to see another day on this day? Praise our God. Before I get into my selection, I have one more announcement. If you are not doing anything this coming Saturday, October the 24th from 12 to 2 p.m., we will be having a parade of gratitude for our pastor. Amen. Pastor Tyrone P. Jones IV having a parade of gratitude. We can't get our arms around him. Well, I can. Y'all can't. Virtually. So we're going to have a parade of gratitude. So if you're not doing anything and you are in the area between 12 and 2 p.m. on Saturday, please come by the church and give your holy wave, amen, and a broad smile so that we might be able to appreciate him. That's at 7504 Oakland Mills Road in Columbia, Maryland. Again, 7504 Oakland Mills, Maryland. Praise our God from 12 to 2 p.m. Now, to the song. Amen, amen. I need thee every hour, most precious Lord. No tender voice like thine can anybody out there need him? Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Oh, stay nearby. Temptations lose their power when thy art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. I need thee, oh bless. I need them every hour. Yes, I do. Every hour I need him. Hallelujah. Come on and put your hands together and bless the Lord.
Amen. 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 God is good. And we are thankful to God for allowing us this opportunity to come together one more time. I want to thank Reverend Jay. Amen. For raising the praise. Amen. Raising the praise in the house of the Lord. Amen. In my house, which has become the house of the Lord. Amen. Once you turn back with me to the book of the Revelation, Revelation chapter 5. And as I stated, it's so much meat on this bone, that I won't be able to get through everything in this time. So I've split it up between this time and next time. And so I want you to open it back up, and what I want to do is read the first seven verses of Revelation chapter 5. And that's the meat of what we'll be dealing with on today. And I read it for you earlier out of the King James. I'm going to do it now through the NIV version of the Bible. It says, "Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?' But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, 'Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals.' Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. The lamb had seven horns, seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne." Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. For just a few minutes, beloved, I want to talk about "Worthy is the Lamb," part one. Worthy is the Lamb, part one. Beloved, as you all know, we're living in trying times. We're living in volatile times. We're living in difficult times. And in these times, I believe as believers, I'm talking about believers in God, that we need to turn to God's word to get a reassurance that things are not going to just be bad, or things are not going to remain as they are, but things will get better. And there's always a reason to rejoice as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, because God has done so much for us by what he did and giving us his son, Jesus Christ. And it's more than just about the fact that he died on the cross and gave us salvation. That is key and that is important. But Jesus has overcome so much so that we do not, even in the midst of a pandemic, have to be worried, have to be frazzled about the things that are to come, about the things that will take place in the future. God's word has outlined for us everything that shall take place in the future. And so that's why I love the book of the Revelation. And it's a book that is filled with some symbolism It's a book that's filled with future truths. But once you get to the point where you can look in this book, Bible says, blessed are those that read from this book. So what I want to do is kind of take from the pivot point of Revelation chapter 5 and to give us an understanding of why the Lamb of God is so worthy. What you must understand is now the Apostle John is under the influence as he is in the midst of heaven, viewing by way of vision something spectacular. And so John now is writing, he's dictating the vision that he is seeing. Bible lets us know that he's on the penal colony called the Isle of Patmos. And during his role, during the rule of the Roman government has now outlawed it for everyone to serve anyone outside of the emperor. So John, refusing to do this, is now banished on the Isle of Patmos. He's put on this penal colony. He's one of the oldest disciples that's left that have been faithfully in fellowship to Jesus. And during the time of the Roman rule, this is under Emperor Domitian. Domitian is the emperor of Rome at this time. And he is scouring the lands, trying to make sure that everyone becomes subservient to those who are under the Roman rule. And so during this time, people were oppressed, they were suppressed, and they were depressed. Suppressed, amen. Suppression, you know, not allowing people to exercise certain rights. Suppressed. They were oppressed. There was hanging over them the heaviness and weight of the challenging times that we're living in. And people were depressed because they were not able to fully be who God had called them to be. So under Nero, the rules were to attack every Christian. And once Nero died, Emperor Domitian comes upon the scene and he rules that everybody had to worship him as God. Christians refused to worship any man because they knew that it was not about giving platitudes or lifting up certain individuals, but it's about giving glory and honor strictly to God. They knew that only Jesus was Lord and King over all. And beloved, I want to remind us early in the sermon that you've got to hang on to this understanding that Jesus Christ is Lord over all. And so under Domitian, John, due to his stance, was exiled on Patmos. During his time, watch this, of isolation on Patmos, his isolation became a place of consecration. And his consecration allowed him to get revelation. I'm going to say that again. So he was put in a place of isolation, put in a place where he was quarantined off to be by himself on this penal colony. While in this place that was supposed to be a place of isolation, he found himself closer to God than ever before. And in this isolation becomes a place of consecration. Then after consecration, God gives him the revelation. And the revelation is what John is writing. While John is receiving this revelation, this unveiling, that's what it means, and revealing of things from God's perspective above, John gets this revelation and he gives it to the people of the first century church. And not only was it valid for those who are the first century church, but it's also valid to us in 21st century. Now notice, if you will, chapter 1, I've got to give you this review so that you can understand where we are currently in Revelation chapter 5. So in chapter 1, John tells us that you are blessed when you read this book. You're blessed by reading the Revelation. In chapters 2 and 3, the message of Christ comes to the seven churches of Asia Minor. And so every pastor, to every leader of these churches, they're given a specific understanding based upon their roles at this time in the first century. In chapter 4, the Bible tells us that John is caught up in a vision, and he sees, the Bible says, an open door in heaven. He sees an open door in heaven. He then hears the magnificent voice of God. And then while the door is open in heaven, he hears the voice of God. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 4 that he sees the throne of God, that God is in charge. So he hears the voice of God's authority. He sees the throne of God, which lets us know that God's in charge. And then he gets a glimpse of the glory that is to come. He sees an open door in heaven. And then when we leave chapter 4, we're now in our current context. John has now been caught away in a vision based on the open door in heaven. He sees the throne of God. He hears the voice of God. And in chapter 5, the one sitting on the throne has in his hand, the Bible says, a scroll or a book, depending on what translation you have, a scroll or book in his right hand. He said, I saw a scroll in the right hand of God, a scroll rolled up with seven seals on it, with the content that nobody knows what's in it until the book is open. You see, nobody could see it. Nobody could open it. In fact, nobody, the Bible says, was worthy, hallelujah, to open the scroll. See, some people say the scroll is about that if you're a believer in God, it's about our future inheritance. It says these seven seals based upon these scrolls that are rolled up, that this book that God is holding in his right hand. Some people believe, and as believers, we believe that it's about the inheritance that is to come for those who are believers in God. For the unbeliever, however, those who don't believe in Jesus, what is held in this scroll, these seven seals, is judgment. Judgment upon the face of the earth. And so when you continue reading, just to give you a synopsis of the book of the Revelation, chapter 6 through 19, then detail for us the opening of the book, the opening of the seals and the scrolls and the vials that shall be poured out upon the earth. And it talks about a 7-year period of tribulation. And I believe, beloved, what's most important for us to know and understand about this scroll, this book that God has in his right hand, is that it in turn is really the title deed of the earth. In this book that nobody else could open is the title deed of what God is going to do upon the face of the earth to transform the earth into an oasis and place where we shall live under God's rule. And I don't know about anybody out there, but I can't wait to see what God does when the earth is changed from the oppression of our time, the suppression of our time, the depression of our time, and put in a place where God wanted it to be from the beginning. In fact, I believe this is what is called the Genesis effect, that God initially created the earth for the inhabitants of his people, that the creation of his hands would be able to live in harmony under a theocracy, a God democracy where God will lead us. But alas, the book, the Bible tells us in Revelation 5, nobody was worthy to open the book. Bible says, in fact, keep looking at the scriptures. It says nobody in heaven, nobody in the earth, nobody under the earth was worthy. It says in verse 3, not the 4 and 20 elders, not the 4 living creatures, not the millions of angels. Nobody was worthy to open the book. So what does that mean to be worthy? To be worthy. To be worthy. Worthy or worth has to deal with character and ability. You have to have the character and the ability, in this instance, for Christ Jesus to open the book. And beloved, I believe this is a note for all of us out there, that God wants to deem us worthy to receive the future inheritance that is to come with all that God is making preparation for, but we have to be found worthy. We have to have the right character. We have to have the right form of integrity, and we have to have the ability to live a life that is pleasing to the Lord Jesus Christ. But in this instance, with all of those who have come through the entire book of the Bible, not one character, not one individual had the ability to open the book. Not Abraham, not Isaac, not Jacob, not Jeremiah, not David, not Paul, not Barnabas, not Priscilla, not Aquila, not Timothy, not Titus. No one was found worthy to open the book. Now, when John, remember now, he's caught up into heaven. When John hears this, the Bible says, keep your Bibles open, that he starts weeping. Verse 4 says, I wept and wept. Why? Because no one was found worthy to open the book or even take a peek inside. And so he began crying while getting a glimpse of glory. And to me, I just took a moment to kind of visualize what's going on here in the text. When John hears this, he starts literally weeping. Notice the emphasis. It says he wept and wept. He was not just crying tranquil tears, but he was bawling. He was weeping because no one was found worthy to open the book. The Bible says he weeps and weeps. No one is found worthy. Now, remember, he's in heaven. But he's in heaven and he's crying. I remember them songs that says there's no crying in glory. Y'all remember them songs with the quartet group? No tears in heaven. No crying in glory. All of our worries with. Oh, what happened to that? In Revelation 5, we see John, the Bible says, caught up into heaven, getting the glimpse of the throne room of God, seeing the 24 elders, seeing the four living creatures. But in this midst, John is found crying. Heaven is not supposed to be a place where there's crying, but he's still found weeping because initially there is no one who is found worthy to open the book. But I love it. Keep reading. Come on with me. Keep your Bibles open. Verse 5 says that when he was weeping uncontrollably, then one of the elders, one of the elders said to him in a nutshell, do not weep. Stop crying. But John is probably saying, but nobody is found worthy to open the book. No one is worthy in heaven. No one is worthy in the earth, under the earth, beneath the sea. There's no character that has the ability to open the book to find and give us the relief that we need from oppression, suppression, and depression. Have you ever been in a place where you're supposed to find relief? And there seems to be no relief in sight. Have you ever been in a place where you pop more pills than you can count, but the headache is still there? The worry is still there. The problem is still. Have you ever been in a place where you have gotten no satisfaction and you done ate everything in the house? You done ate up all the chicken. All the hog maul, amen. All the pinto beans, amen. You done ate up everything in the house and you still depressed. Have you ever been in a place where you find yourself not finding the relief or release that you need in the midst? John could find no one who was worthy to open the book. But one of the elders said, stop and look over there. Verse 5, don't miss me here. Verse 5, over there is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David. Don't miss your shout cue. This is Jesus, the Messiah. Yes. Now, I need you to understand why the elder said the lion of the tribe of Judah and why the elder said the root of David. The lion of Judah, lion denotes power and strength. Lion of the tribe of Judah, Judah denotes praise and adoration. There is one who's coming in power. There is one who's going to be worthy of praise, who will be able to take the book out of God who is seated on the throne. Take the book out of the hand of God. And the Lion of Judah is the one who has the power and strength to do it. The root of David means that he is the king, that he is the anointed one. He is the one called and sanctioned by God to bring forth release and relief for his children who are found weeping in a place where they're supposed to find relief. This is why Jesus Christ is the worthy lamb. This is why he is worthy. Worthy is the lamb because he's the Lion of Judah and he's the root of David. But watch it, watch it. Before John saw Jesus, he had a reason to cry. Watch this. But once he sees the Savior, it becomes a totally different ball game. But before he saw doors open, he saw throne rooms, he saw trumpets, no doubt he saw the incandescent light and mixture of brilliant colors, the rainbow of the sky in glory, but he did not see Jesus. What is that telling us? That's telling us this: I don't care how high you get, I don't care how high you get in life, if you lose sight of Jesus, you will be oppressed, suppressed, and depressed, even though you've reached unattainable heights. If you don't keep Jesus in line of sight, you will miss the glory of God and you will find yourself in a sad situation. You can be in a palatial palace and still be depressed. You can have all the resources around you and still not have all you need. I don't care how high you get in life. If you lose sight of Jesus Christ, you will be sad and you'll be depressed. You'll be down, dismayed, and disjointed. But when you get a good look at Jesus, come on now, you then will be able to stop weeping, stop crying, and give God the glory. You may have a nice car, but you know what? What's having a nice car when you're depressed while driving? Come on. You may have a nice house, but you hate your house because your house is not a home. I'm not going to give you Luther right now. Amen. You may have a good job, but still on that good job, there's still a whole lot of mess going on. Never, no matter how high God lifts you, lose sight of Jesus. And maybe it's because you've lost sight of Jesus. Watch it. Verse 5, the elder said, look, watch the text. I see the Lion of Judah, the root of David. But watch verse 6. Can I give you verse 6? Verse 6 says, John looked and said, in the midst of the throne, there were four beasts and the elders, and there stood a lamb. Did y'all see it? Don't miss it. Please don't read too fast. Look at the difference between verse 5 and verse 6. When the elder saw Jesus, he saw the Lion of the tribe of Judah, and he saw the root of David. But when you go to verse 6 says, then I saw, that's John, I saw a lamb. This thing blessed me, y'all. It blessed me. Look, John looked in the midst of the throne, saw all the elders, saw the four living creatures, but there he saw standing in the midst a lamb. The elder and John were both looking at Jesus, But one saw the Lion of Judah while the other saw the Lamb of God. What is that telling us, beloved? What is that telling us? That's telling us everybody who looks at Jesus can see what they need to see out of Jesus in order to address the needs that you have. I'm running out of time. I got to wrap this up. Listen. Everybody can look at Jesus, but we see what we need him to be in our lives. And at any given time, you could be the elder looking for the lion, the conqueror of the government that is before us. Or you can be like John, needing a lamb who takes away the sin of the world. Whatever you need Jesus to be, God help me. At any time you need Jesus to be it, just look to Jesus. Jesus will be whatever you need him to be. Jesus is limitless in that way. And whatever you need, he'll give it to you. Whatever you need him to do, he'll do it for you. And so different connotation and different manifestations of Christ can take place. To some, he is Emmanuel, God with us. To others, he's wonderful, he's counselor, he's mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. To others, he's bread and water. To others, he's a door. He's the good shepherd. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Whatever you need Jesus to be, when you look to the Lord, he'll be that. I'm almost done with part one. Listen, text says so much here. Text says that the Lamb was in the center of everything. Watch this, and I'm done. John finally got a focus on Jesus. He went, door was open. He sees the throne room of God. He hears the voice of God. He sees the book in the right hand of God. No one is found worthy. He looks all around and he starts crying, finds no relief. He's crying uncontrollably. The elder tells him, stop crying. Look over there. Worthy is the Lamb. And what I noticed about this, finally, when John focused on Jesus in the midst, verse 6, everything changed the moment he put his focus on the one who was in the center of the room. Here's my point. Who are you focusing on? What and who are you focusing on in the center of the room? Are you looking to Jesus? Jesus was in the midst of everything. And when John focused and fixed his eyes on Christ, his tears of sorrow became tears, no doubt, of joy. Yes. Why, Pastor Jones? Because when my focus is on Christ, Christ moves everything else out of the way and puts into perspective everything that I'm going through. Here it is. John got distracted when he reached another level or a high place, and he became sad, upset, disillusioned. But when he put his focus on Jesus and everything became Christ-centered, I hope y'all hearing me, everything became Christ-centered, he was able to see what he needed to see. Here's the thing, y'all, and I'm done. That's enough for the first part. Amen. Here's the thing. Don't be distracted by everything around you that you miss Jesus right there in front of you. Don't be distracted by everything happening around us that you miss Jesus in the midst of everything that's going on. In fact, you should be asking yourself, with everything going on in the world, with everything that's taking place in the United States, with everything that's taking place in Nigeria, with everything that's taking place in the world right now, we need to be asking the question, Lord, where are you in the midst? And when we focus our eyes on the one who is already in the center of the room, we'll then be able to see what we need to see and not be distracted by what's coming or going on. So don't come into this getting distracted But make sure you see Jesus. All right, that's enough. Part one. Amen. I got so much more to give you, but that's part one. Bible lets us know that he saw Jesus and his focus began to shift because now as the elder has shown him, there is one worthy to open the book that will usher in the inheritance for those who are believers and the judgment for those who are unbelievers. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, thank you for this word. Thank you, God, for allowing us to dive deep in the book of the Revelation and to get a greater understanding of the things that are to come. Thank you for the vision, Lord God, the insight and foresight that you gave the Apostle John, that he would write it down and pass it along to us, that we might not, Lord God, be mystified by the things that are going on the earth right now. We might not, Lord God, be put in a place where we don't understand the things that are to come. But while we're travailing, while we're waiting, while we're in the midst of all that's going on around us, God, help us keep our focus on the one who is in the center of the throne room, the one who is now our great high priest, the one who is praying, Lord, at the altar for all of the children of God. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for all that you have done and all that you continue to do for all of us as children. Now, God, bless us as we go forward. And Lord God, may we go triumphantly saying, worthy is the Lamb. God, you're worthy of all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, that's part one, y'all. I got more to give you, but I can't do it till next week. I'm not out of word, but Lord knows I'm out of time. Amen. God bless you all. Heaven smile upon you. Listen, look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, and he'll carve out a plan that's already been laid for us to follow. God bless you. See y'all tonight, 7 o'clock, Fall Institute. Be blessed. Amen.